There was a time I used to look into my father's eyes. In a happy home, I was a king, I had a golden throne. Those days are gone, now the memories on the wall. I hear the songs from the places where I was born. Upon a hill across the blue lake, that's where I had my first heartbreak. I still remember how it all changed. My father said, don't you worry, child. She has got a plan for you. Don't you worry now.
Good afternoon and welcome to Walls of Distance Education. My name is Greg Weaver and this is ENG3C, Grade 11, College Prep English. I'd like to welcome everyone listening across the world today at home, your learning center, or on Bell Express View. To call and join our class, you can call 1-800-465-7144 or 737-4017 or 2983 if you're in the Sioux Lookout, Lac Seul, or Dryden area. So welcome everyone back today. Hope everyone had a good weekend. I am talking today from Dance and Comedy High School here in Thunder Bay. I'm out here for a conference, so we're having class from here today. I want to remind everyone that class is canceled tomorrow. I will be doing my presentation. However, we will have class again as scheduled on Wednesday and Thursday. And we will also have a makeup class on Friday. Now, makeup class is scheduled for Friday at 10 a.m. Central, 11 a.m. Pacific, Eastern Time. So that's something to just keep in mind. Now, if you can't make the makeup class, it will be recorded in the archives, and it will be available on YouTube as well. So what we're going to do now, we're going to jump right into...
We put an announcement. Because of the numerous late and absences in the first period,
we are going to...
these people report to my room, 113 and
14. We are going to look at lesson 3. And we are going to be looking at chapter 3 from To Kill a Mockingbird as well. So if you're on Bridget, you'll notice that the mic isn't open, and that's because I don't have a mic here in Thunder Bay. However, you can call into class and hear everything that's going on. So we're looking at lesson 3, which looks at the editorial. So what this is, we're going to look at what is an editorial and how it differs from a regular news article. Because remember, last week we looked at lesson 2, which looked at how to write a news article that's based on discrimination. And the key question number 2 you did in that lesson was to write a news article based on either an incident that you happened to personally or one that you saw occur. As well, if you have never either experienced one or seen one happen, you can choose an example that you saw from that you saw in a TV show or in a movie.
To talk
to your principal and give a reason why you were late or asked to fill the first period. Again, come to my office, come to my room, 113, sign, and proceed on to the principal's office with your excuse. So we are going to be looking at that today. So up on Bridget, you'll see lesson 3. So it says, news articles must explore current events from an objective or unbiased point of view, an editorial has the freedom to not only explore specific events that have occurred, but also to explore the author's feelings, either positive or negative, on those events. So we look, get down to this. What we see is what's called basic editorial format. This is what we're looking at for this lesson. So an editorial is a brief written commentary on a specific subject. It's different than a news article that we looked at in lesson two. Editorials express opinions, beliefs, or judgments. They are usually written by newspaper or magazine editors or by guest writers. Most newspapers have a section that contains several editorial and opinion pieces, as well as letters to the editor. The letters are often readers' responses to recent editorials. Good editorial writing and writers must do more than express their opinions. They must write persuasively. Now, persuasion is the art of convincing another person to accept an opinion. So most editorials have four main elements. A proposition, which is a statement that tells you the writer's opinion on that topic. It's usually found in the introduction, although it may be repeated in the conclusion, or rarely, not stated until all at all until the conclusion. The proposition is for an editorial. It's the need. The proposition on editorials on the need for more substandard daycare spaces might be: too many children are placed in substandard daycare environments because their parents cannot afford better care and still support the family. That's the main idea. That's what the main idea is about, and what the writer's opinion on that idea is. Saying message to one of our students here. Context next. That is, what's the background? Why is this article being written in the first place? So the context for an editorial is a circumstance that prompts the writer to express his or her opinion. Often the editorial begins by stating the context. An example for a context of an article that examines the need for more substance daycare spaces might be a proposed government bill. The editorial may begin by saying Bill 47 must be passed to ensure that no more children go without quality daycare. The context for this editorial that a program bill is to provide subsidized daycare. Next is their evidence. How do they prove? How do they support their point? Well, editorial writers use evidence to bring the readers around to their point of view. This evidence may be based on fact or on expert opinion. Editorial writers are not concerned with presenting an unbiased, objective view of the events. That is what a news article is. This is designed to persuade you to take one point of view or not. However, good editorials make a clear distinction between facts and opinion. In our subsidized daycare example, the author could use specific examples of people who have been placed in this position, as well as statistics that examine how many families in the area have trouble finding or paying for appropriate daycare. The editorial could also include comments from a sociologist explaining the effects poor daycare can have on young children. And the last part of this is logical or emotional language. Now, this is how they get you to actually believe what they're saying. Most editorial writers use both vivid language that appeals to your minds, or logical language, and to our hearts, an emotional language. Whether they use mainly logical or emotional language depends on the issue that they are discussing and the audience for whom they write. The easiest way to appeal to your reader's heart is to use a highly content or highly biased language. We talked about bias in class last week and look at Unit 2. In your news article, you want to try and keep it neutral. You want to tell both sides of the story equally, if you can. With an editorial, you don't have to do that. Instead, you want to use biased language because you want to try and make the person convinced that your point of view is the correct point of view. One other important aspect of an editorial that it should be written using formal language, no slang, short forms, or jargon, but it can use first and second person. This means if you state, "I cannot believe," which is first person because that uses I, or think about how you would feel if, and that's second person. Now, it's not very often you see second person writing, but when you see you, how would you feel, that's second person.
Number Beardy, could you come to the front office, Number Beardy? Thank you.
So, we want to look at an editorial based on discrimination in society. Remember that the writer of an editorial wants you to share his or her opinion. To achieve that objective, the writer should present clear, well-reasoned arguments that are supported with evidence. However, the writer may have deliberately excluded some facts that would have supported the opposing point of view. Remember that only showing one side of the story is an example of bias. He or she may also have used biased language and language that appeals to your emotions. You need to read editorials with an open yet critical mind. Being critical does not mean being nitpicky. It usually means using sound reasoning to think for yourself and to form your own opinions. Here are some tips to keep in mind as you read an editorial. You must first scan the article to find out what the title and subject is, what it's about, and what you can find out about the author. If there's any little explanation of who the author is. Next is, what is the author's proposition for this editorial? What's their argument? What are they trying to prove by writing this? Next, be aware of your own biases. If you disagree with the author's opinion, do you have sound evidence to support an opposing point of view? You just want to pay attention to the author's biases. What might the author be expressing in this editorial, and why would we be expressing that opinion? And you want to distinguish between the author's opinions and the facts that are presented in this editorial. Now, notice whether the author appeals to your logic to your emotions, or to both. If you come across any words you don't completely understand, make sure that you look them up using a dictionary or a website to dictionary.com. Now we're going to read the editorials on the next page. It explores discrimination in today's society and reminds us that discrimination has not yet been eliminated. So this editorial is called Ban Smoking Rooms. So it says, my mother died recently from cancer. Not just any cancer, but lung cancer. She didn't smoke, but my father did, like a chimney for the entire 34 years that they were married. He died 6 years ago, a heart attack. He would never know the devastation he caused in the family he left behind. It is time for the government to do everything it can to reduce the number of people smoking, especially those who smoke in public places like smoking rooms. There are two good reasons to get rid of Toronto's designated smoking rooms, all 185 of them.
Hello, Greg.
Hello.
This is Charlotte calling from Redmall.
Hello, Charlotte.
I'm listening at home again.
No problem. We're on Bridget, but there's no mic feed on Bridget today just because I'm calling in from DFC.
Okay.
Okay?
Okie dokie.
Thank you. And we're just on page 28 of Unit 1.
Okay.
So first, there's good evidence that some of these rooms are not protecting non-smokers from toxic secondhand fumes. Doors to the smoking room have been left open in some establishments, allowing clouds of cancer-causing chemicals to escape. In other cases, non-smokers may be pressured into sitting in the smoking zone in order to meet with their tobacco-using colleagues or even their bosses. A second reason to permanently shut down these rooms is for the sake of smokers themselves. Tobacco-related illnesses kill an estimated 16,000 Ontarians each year. Strong steps are warranted to discourage this deadly addiction. Shutting designated smoking rooms would make indulging in a cigarette more inconvenient than it is now. And that, coupled with the stinging increase in tobacco taxes, would go a long way in pushing many smokers towards kicking their addictive habit. Ontario Health Minister George Smithern has promised aggressive legislation to ban smoking workplaces and indoor spaces by year 2007. And Toronto Board of Health is quite rightly urging the ban designated smoking rooms as part of the attack on tobacco. The local health panel is even considering acting alone if Smitherman failed to deliver. In that event, the city's medical officer of health is to report back to the board on a proposal to ban smoking in Toronto by June 1st, 2007. Hopefully, Smitherman won't disappoint. All of Ontario needs protection. As expected, the powerful tobacco lobby and its allies in the bar and restaurant trade are fighting to keep smoke rooms open. They worry about lost business. Ultimately, the choice is between saving dead smoke rooms or saving human lives. And the correct path could not be more obvious. That came out in 2004. Now, a lot of things have changed in the 10 years. Actually, almost 11 years now. Smoking is banned in all public places. You can't smoke in cars anymore if it's kids in the car. And you have to smoke at least 45 feet away from any door. and you can't smoke at all in any restaurant, bar, or any workplace, and that includes any work vehicle. So a lot of things have changed in 11 years when this was written. So, with that, we get into our support questions. Having read the editorial above, test your knowledge by answering the following support questions. The first one is, what is the author's proposition for this editorial? Second one is, what is the context of the editorial? The third one says, provide three examples of bias or emotional language used by the author. And number four says, name two different types of evidence that's used by the author. Now, you'll find suggested answers to this question at the end of the unit. We're going to go there right now and look at those suggested answers. So first is lesson three. So the proposition is, it's time for the government to do everything it can to reduce the number of people smoking, especially those who smoke in public places like smoke rooms. That is what we could consider the thesis of this editorial. That is the point that all this comes together. That's the reason why it's being written, and that's the point that the author is trying to get across. Now, next is, what's the context? What's the backstory that's making this writer write about this? And it says, the context that the author's mother recently died of lung cancer caused by secondhand smoke, and the author wants to prevent more deaths. And what's an example of biased or emotional language? Well, we have words like devastation, toxic, cancer-causing chemicals, deadly addiction, indulging, stinging increase. Those are all words that really help to really hammer home and really emphasize the point that this author's trying to make. Those are loaded words. They are biased words. But the reason why they're there is to really make you think about what is going on with that. And then there's two types of evidence. You have specific examples, stats, and you have a quote too. So example is, doors of smoking rooms have been left open in some establishments. Their stats are that it killed 16,000 Ontarians every year. And there's a quote that they need a, quote, aggressive legislation was promised by the then health minister. And if we look into, go back up to our thing, we get into our key questions. So before we get to the key questions, which right here, which is on page 29, I just want to quickly run through this, and then we're going to read chapter 3 in our course novel, To Kill a Mockingbird. And then we'll come back to these questions and keep working through. I want to read through them first, just in case we don't get back to this today. You can get started with it, and then we can always come back to it again on Wednesday. And we have no class tomorrow, because I'll be presenting at a conference here in Thunder Bay. But we do have class on Wednesday at our normal time. And we have a makeup class on Friday for tomorrow's class. So So because we're going to miss it, we need to make it up. So there's two parts to key question number three. The first part says, using the knowledge gained during your investigation of editorials, you are to write an original editorial. The source or basis for this article is to be the exact same act of discrimination that you reported on in the last lesson. The primary purpose of this activity is to demonstrate that you understand the format of editorial and that you can adapt objective information, your own article, to report the same information subjectively or biased. You'll be evaluated using the following criteria. For the structure, how it's laid out, is 5 marks. For the evidence that you use and how you change it into from objective into subjective is 10 marks. And the use of biased or emotional language is also another 5 marks. So the entire basis for this editorial is the same act of discrimination that you wrote about in key question number 2. So you have to complete key question 2 before you start with this activity. So we haven't finished key question 2 yet. Please get that done as soon as possible. And number 2, once you have that done, you have to write the editorial first. The second one is a bit of a journal response, asking your opinion. So it says, now that you have written both a news article and an editorial on the same example of discrimination, you need to give some thought as to which was easier to write. Was the news article, which required you to be unbiased throughout, but did not require much development, easier? Or was the editorial, which allowed you free reign with your language, easier, despite the extra development needed? When you have come to a conclusion as to which one you prefer to use, write a journal of about 100 words. You're looking at about, if you're doing it on lined paper, about half a page. If you're on a computer, I'm looking for 2 paragraphs. That clearly states your conclusion and give specific reasons why that form was easier for you to write. And that's worth 10 marks for how you well you can explain yourself. Now, with this question, this is entirely your opinion. What you have to do is decide which one is easier to write, the news article or the editorial. Now you have to complete both of these activities before you can do this question. And we'll come back and look at this a bit more probably tomorrow, because I don't think we'll finish chapter 3. But now we're going to jump right into our course novel again. Now I don't have the exact page number, because I don't have a novel in front of me. All I have is this electronic copy. But we left off, I believe it's around page 29 or page 30. So it's chapter 3. Now, just a quick recap so far. Chadwick is going to introduce to Jem and Scout Finch, who is the protagonist and her brother. Atticus, who's their father. Calpurnia, who's their cook or maid. Dill, who is one of their friends, who's gone back to Mobile for the wintertime. And in chapter 2, we had Scout's first day of grade 1. And her morning was pretty eventful. She got smacked by the teacher. Because this time you could still, and this time you could hit students. And she got embarrassed in front of the whole class because the teacher was embarrassing the other students. So we're going to keep going with chapter 3 now and go from there. I believe this is around page 29 or page 30 of your course novel, somewhere around there. So catching Walter Cunningham in the schoolyard gave me some pleasure, but when I was rubbing his nose in the dirt, Jeff came by and told me to stop. "You're bigger than he is," he said. "He's as old as you nearly," I said. "He made me start off on the wrong foot. Let him go, Scout." "Why?" "He didn't have any lunch," I said, and explained my involvement in Walter's dietary affairs. Walter had picked himself up and was standing quiet, listening to Jim and me. His fists were half-cocked, as if expecting an onslaught from both of us. I started to chase him away, but Jim put out his hand and stopped me. He examined Walter's air of speculation. "Your daddy, Mr. Walter Cunningham, from Old Sarum?" he asked, and Walter nodded. Walter looked as if he had been raised on fish food. His eyes, as blue as Dill Harris's, were red-rimmed and watery. There was no color in his face, except the tip of his nose, which is mostly pink. He fingered the straps of the overalls, nervously picking at the metal hooks. Jim said, grinned at him. "Come on home to have dinner with us, Walter," he said. "We'll be glad to have you." Walter's face brightened and then darkened. He said, "Our daddy's a friend of your daddy. Skelter, she's crazy. She won't fight you anymore." "I wouldn't be concerned with that," I said, and Jem's free dispensation of my pledge irked me. But precious noontime minutes were ticking away. "Yeah, Walter, I won't jump you again. Don't you like butter beans? Our cow's a real good cook." Walter stood where he was, biting his lip. Jim and I gave up, and we're nearly to the rabbit pace, and Walter cried, "Hey, I'm coming." When Walter caught up with us, Jim made pleasant conversation with him. I ain't lived there," he said coldly, pointing to Radley House. "We hear of him, Walter?" "Reckon I have," said Walter. "Almost died first year I came to school and ate them pigons. Folks say he poisoned them and put them over the school side of the fence." Jem seemed a little afraid of Boo Radley now that Walter and I walked beside him. Indeed, Jem grew boastful. "I went all the way up to the house once," he said to Walter. "Anybody who left the house once ought to still not run every time he passes," I said to the clouds above. "And who's running, Miss Pris?" "You are, but ain't nobody with you." By the time we reached our front steps, Walter had forgotten he was the Cunningham. Jim ran to the kitchen, asked the parents for an extra plate. We had company. Atticus greeted Walter and began a discussion about crops neither Jim or I could follow. "The reason I can't pass the first grade, Mr. Finch, is I have to stay out every spring and help Papa with the chopping. There's another in the house now that's field size." "Do you pay a bunch of potatoes for him?" I asked. Atticus shook his head at me. When Walter piled food on his plate, he and Atticus talked together like two men, to the wonderment of Jim and me. Atticus was expounding upon farm problems when Walter interrupted to ask if there was any more molasses in the house. Atticus summoned Calpurnia, who returned bearing the syrup pitcher. She stood waiting for Walter to help himself. Walter poured syrup on his vegetables and meat with a generous hand. He probably would have poured it into his milk glass had I not asked him what the sandhill he was doing. Silver saucer clattered when he replaced the pitcher, and he quickly put his hand in his lap and ducked his head. Atticus shook his head at me. "But he's gone and drowned his dinner in syrup," I protested. "He poured it all over. It was like a perennial question of my presence in the kitchen." She was furious. And when she was furious, Calpurnia's grammar became erratic. When in tranquility, her grammar was as good as anybody's in Macomb. Atticus said Calpurnia had more education than most colored folks. When she squinted down at me, the tiny lines around her eyes deepened. "There's some folks who don't eat like us," she whispered fiercely. "But you ain't called them to contradict them at the table and they don't. That boy's your company, and if he wants to eat at the tablecloth, you let him, you hear? He ain't company cow, he's just a Cunningham. hush your mouth. Don't matter who they are. Enemy sets foot in this house is your company. And don't you let me catch you and mark in the other ways like you are so high and mighty. Your folks let you bear in the Cunninghams, but it don't come for nothing the way you're disgracing them. You can't act fit to eat at the table, you can just sit here and eat in the kitchen. Copernicus sent me through the swinging door to the dining room for the stinging smack. I retrieved my plate and finished dinner in the kitchen. Thankful, though, that I was spared the humiliation of facing them again. I told Copernicus to just wait. I fixed her. One of these days when she was looking off, I'd go down and drown myself in Barker's Eddy, and then she'd be sorry. Besides, I added, she'd already gotten me into trouble once today. She taught me how to write, and it was all her fault. Hush your fussing, she said. Jim and Walter returned to school ahead of me. Staying behind to advise Atticus of Copernicus' inequities was a solitary sprint past the Radley place. She likes Jim better than she likes me anyways, I concluded. It's just that Atticus lose no time in packing her off. You ever consider that Jim don't wear her half as much? Agnes was as flimsy. I have no intention of getting rid of her now or ever. We couldn't offer a single day without Cal. You ever thought of that? You think about how much Cal does for you. And you mind her, you hear? I returned to school and hated Calpurnia steadily until a sudden shriek shattered my resentment. I looked up to see Miss Caroline standing in the middle of the room, sheer horror flooding her face. Apparently, she had revived enough to persevere in her profession. It's alive, she screamed. The male population of the class rushed as one to her assistance. Lord, I thought. She's scared of a mouse. Little Chuck Little, whose patience with all living things was phenomenal, said, which way to go, Miss Caroline? Tell us where you went, quick. DC turned to the boy behind him. DC, shut the door and we'll catch him. Quick, ma'am, where'd he go? This kind of pointed a shaking finger not at the floor nor our desk, but at a hulking individual known to me. Charlie's face contradicted me and said warmer to gently, you mean him, ma'am? Yes, he's alive. Did he scare you some way? Miss Karen said desperately, I was just walking with him and it crawled all of his hair. It just crawled all of his hair. Little Chuck grinned broadly. There ain't no need for fear of cootie, ma'am. Ain't you ever seen one? No, don't you be afraid. Just go back to your desk and teach us some more. Little Chuck Little was another member of the population who didn't know where his next one was coming from. But he was a born gentleman. He put his hand under her elbow and led Miss Caroline to the front of the room. Now don't you fret, ma'am, he said. There ain't no fear of a cootie. I'll just fetch you some cool water. The cootie's host showed not the faintest interest in the fury he had wrought. He searched his scalp on his forehead, located his guest, and pinched between his thumb and forefinger. Miss Caroline watched the process in horrid fascination. Little Chuck brought her water in a paper cup, and she drank it gratefully. Finally, she found her voice. What's your name, son? She asked softly. The boy blinked. Who, me? Miss Caroline nodded. Burris Yule. Miss Caroline inspected her roll book. I have a Yule here, but I don't have a first name. How to spell your first name for me? I don't know how. They call me Burris at home. Well, Burris, said Miss Caroline, thank you for excusing me the rest of the afternoon. I want you to go home and wash your hair. From her dish, she produced a thick volume, leafed through its pages, and read for a moment. A good homework for Burris. I want you to go home and wash your hair with lye soap. Do not treat your scalp with kerosene. What for, Mrs.? To get rid of the cooties. See, Burris, I thought you might catch them. I wouldn't want that, would you? Well, the boy stood up. He was the filthiest human that I'd ever seen. His neck was dark gray. The back of his hands were rusty. His fingernails were black deep into the quick. He peered at Miss Caroline from a fist-sized clean face on his face. No one had noticed him, probably because Miss Caroline and I entertained the class most of the morning. And Burris, please bathe yourself before you come back tomorrow. The boy laughed rudely. You ain't going to send me home, Mrs. I was on the verge of leaving. I didn't have time for this year. Miss Caroline looked puzzled. What do you mean by that? The boy did not answer. He gave a short, contemptuous snort. One of the elderly members of the class answered, he's one of the you old men. I wondered if his explanation was unsuccessful as an attempt, but Miss Caroline seemed willing to listen. The whole school's full of them. They come the first day every year and then leave. The truant lady gets some here because she's with the sheriff, but she can't try to hold them. She reckons she's carried out the law by getting their names in the roll, running them here the first day. He's forced to work them out for the rest of the year. What about the parents, asked Caroline, in genuine concern? Ain't got no mother, was the answer, and their pa's right contentious. Virgil was flattered by the recital. He's coming to the first day of first grade for 3 years now, he said expansively. Reckon if I'm smart this year, they're going to the second. Miss Caroline said, sit back down, please, Burris. And the moment she said it, I knew she'd made a mistake. The boy's condensation flashed into anger. You try and make me, missus. Lil Chuck got to his feet. Let him go, man, he said. He's a mean one. A hard-down mean one. He's liable to start something, and there's some little folks here. He's one of the most diminutive of men. But when Burris Ewell turned towards him, Lil Chuck's right hand went to his pocket. Watch your step, Burris, he said. I'd soon as kill you to look at you. Now go home. Burris seemed afraid of a child half his height. And Miss Cannon took advantage of his indecision. Burris, go home. If you don't, I'll call the principal. She said, I'll have to report this anyways. The boy snorted and slouched leisurely towards the door. Safely out of range, he turned and shouted, report and be damned to ya. Ain't no snot-nose of a school teacher ever born can make me do nothing. You ain't making me go nowhere, missus. You remember that? You ain't making me go nowhere. Wait until he was sure she was crying. Then he shuffled out of the building. Soon we were clustered around her desk, trying our various ways to comfort her. He was a real mean one. Really below the belt. You ain't called on to teach folks like that. This ain't Macon's way, Miss Karen. Not really. Now, don't you fret, ma'am. Why don't you raise a story? That cat thing was real fine this morning. Miss Karen blew her nose and said, thank you, dog. His first test opened a book in the mystified of the first grade with a long hair with a toad frog that lived in a hall. When I passed the Radley place for the fourth time that day, twice at full gallop, my gloom had deepened to match the house. If the remainder of the school year was fraught with drama the first day, perhaps it would be mildly entertaining, but the prospect of spending 9 months refraining from reading and merely made me think of running away. The late afternoon, most of my traveling plans were complete. When Jim and I reached the sidewalk to meet Agnes come home from work, I didn't get much of a race. It was our habit to run to meet Agnes the moment we saw him around the post office corner in the distance. Agnes seemed to have forgotten my noontime fall from grace. He was so full of questions of our school. I was a monosyllabic and did not press me. Perhaps go pretty in a sense of David and grim one. Let me watch her fix supper. Shut your eyes and open your mouth. I'll give you a surprise, she said. It was not often she made just crackling bread. She said she never had time, but both of us were at school today. Give an easy one for her. She knew I loved crackling bread. Let me see today, she said. Alice felt so lonesome, long about 2 o'clock, I just turned on the radio. Why? Jimmy ain't never in the house unless it's raining. I know, she said, but one of you's always in calling distance. I wonder how much of the day I spent calling after you. Well, she said, getting up from the kitchen chair. Enough time to make a pan of crackling bread, I reckon. You're along now, and let me get supper on the table. Caprina bent down and kissed me. I ran along, wondering what had come over her. She had someone to keep me up with me, so that was it. She's always so been too hard on me. She'd last seen the error of her ways. and she was snoring too stubborn to say so. I was reading from the day's crimes. After supper, Atticus sat down on the pinnacle. Scout, ready to read? Lord sent me more than I could bear, and went to the front porch. Atticus followed me. Something wrong, Scout? I told Atticus I didn't feel well and didn't think I'd go to school anymore if I was alright with him. Atticus sat down on the swing and crossed his legs. His fingers wandered to his watch pocket. He said that was the only way he could think. He waited in amiable silence, and I sat in his position. You went to school and you did all right, so I'll just stay home too. You can teach my granddaddy to tell you and Uncle Jack. No, I can't, said Atticus. I have to make a living. Besides, it put me in jail if I kept you home. Dose of magnesia for each night and school tomorrow. Feeling right, really. I thought, you know, what's the matter? Get my bed, I told my day's misfortune, and she said you taught me all wrong. I can't ever read anymore, please. Don't send me back, please, sir. Atticus stood up and walked to the end of the porch. When he completed his examination of the wisteria vine, he strolled back to me. First of all, I said, if you can learn a simple trick, Scout, you'll get along with all kinds of folks. You never really understand a person until you consider things from his point of view, sir, until you climb into his skin and walk around in it. Like I said, I learned many things today. And Miss Caroline had learned several things herself. She had learned not to hand something to a Cunningham, for one thing. But if Walter and I had put ourselves in her shoes, we have seen an honest mistake on her part. We could not expect her to learn all of Maycomb's ways in one day. We could not hold her responsible when she knew no better. I'll be dogged, I said. I don't know any better not to read to her. She's only responsible. Listen to that, kids. I don't have to go to school. I was bursting or something. Beerus Ewell, remember? He schooled school for the first day. The truth that he reckons he's carried out the law when he goes to school the first day. You can't get his name on the roll. You can't do that, Scout, said Atticus. Sometimes it's better to bend the law a little in special cases. In your case, law remains rigid, so school you must go. Well, I don't see why I have to. If he doesn't, then listen. Atticus said the Yule was a disgrace to make him for three generations. No one had done an honest day's work in his recollection. He said that some Christmas, when he was getting rid of the tree, he would take you with him and show you where and how they lived. They were people, but they lived like animals. They can go to school anytime they want to, when they show the faintest sense of wanting education, said Atticus. There are ways of keeping them in school by force, but still to force people like Yule into a new environment. If I didn't leave to go to school tomorrow, you'd force me. Leave it at this, said Atticus dryly. You, Miss Scout Finch, are of the common folk. You must obey the law. He said the Yules were members of an exclusive society made up of Yules. It was in certain circumstances the common folk justly allowed them certain privileges by a simple method of being blind on Yule activities. They have to go to school for one thing. Another thing, Mr. Bob Yule, Burris's father, is ready to hunt and trap out of season. Heck, if that's bad, I said, Macon County, hunting out of season was a misdemeanor at law, kept a felony in the eyes of the populace. It's against the law, right, said my father. It's certainly bad, but when the man sends his relief checks on green whiskey, his children have a way of crying from hunger pains. Does any land around who begrudges those children any game that their father can hit? Mr. Yule shouldn't do that. Of course he shouldn't, but he'll never change his ways. Are you going to take all your school on his children? No, sir, I murmured, made a final stand. But if you keep going to school, we can never read anymore. That's really bothering you, isn't it? Yes, sir. I just came down to look at me. I saw an expression on his face that always made me expect something. Do you know what compromise is? He asked. Bending the law? No, an agreement agrees by mutual concessions. It works this way, he said. If you can see the necessity of going to school, we'll go and ring every night, just as we always have. Is it a bargain? Yes, sir. We'll consider it sealed without these formalities, he said, when he saw me behind the spit. As I opened the store front door, Agnes said, by the way, Scout, you better not say anything about school or our agreement. Why not? For our activities we receive, but must consider with disprobation by the more learned authorities. Do you were accustomed to my father's last will and testament diction? We are free at all times. And you're all the time free to interrupt Atticus for translation when he was beyond our understanding. Huh? sister, and I went to school, he said, but I have a feeling that if you tell Miss Karen to leave you every night, she'll get after me. We want her after me. August came on 5th of the evening. Miss Gabriel called the printer about a man who sat on a flag for no simple reason. He was run for Jim from the following Saturday, lost in the treehouse. Jim sat from breakfast till after sunset. Remained overnight, Haggis not severed his supply lines. I spent most of the day climbing up and down, running errands for him, primed with literature, nourishment, and water, carrying blankets for the night. When Agus said I paid no attention to him, Jim would come down. Agus was right. And that's what we'll end for today. We have no class tomorrow. We have class again on Wednesday from Sioux Lookout. We will finish up looking at question 3 and start with lesson number 4. If you have any questions, I can be reached by email or by Facebook. Other than that, I'll talk to everyone again on Wednesday. Till then, McGwich, and bye for now.